The Chrognomes, Part 2. In earlier generations, closer to the time of the gnoming, that is, when it had been suggested that they were becoming gnomes, questions had been put forward, such as, what about the stereotyped habits of the different varieties of gnome? And what about the supposed magical abilities of mythical peoples? And even, how many varieties of gnome are we supposed to be? But already, the shorter varieties were starting to prefer living underground, especially in hollows under tree roots, and occasionally sharing dens with animals at that stage. And some of the slightly taller, pointy-eared varieties were starting to prefer living among tree branches. Some varieties even took a liking to living on the outskirts of the big people settlements. None had ever lived inside a mushroom or toadstool, but there were plenty of mycelium around the subterranean homes, which might have given rise to that confusion. Later, different varieties started taking preferences for different tasks and industries as well. The dwarves, for example, took up most of the mining and metallurgy work, and other varieties were happy to let them. The tree elves took up forestry and orcharding. The duende in the east started developing a kind of symbiotic agriculture with some insect species. Some started getting on unusually well with animals, which worked well when the animal acted as cover for them around big people. Then they in turn made sure that the animal didn't get into trouble on their behalf. This presumably gave rise to stories among big people across many continents about shapeshifters. A few gnomes of different species developed close working relationships, even far away from big people, with other animals, some with birds and some with mammals, and even a few with reptiles, depending on the environment. The falconets of Southeast Asia being the most suitable for work as hunting companions. Other elves took up tailoring and leather work. Soon they developed not just preferences, but considerable natural ability and instinct for their chosen industries. There was eventually an incident where a few elves took pity on a big person cobbler and helped him make some extra shoes. This led to considerable debate over the secrecy versus moral obligation to help those in need, even big people. Eventually, as technology and technique developed further for hiding them, some, mostly smallish subterranean cities and woodland towns developed. As they spread, the big people cities developed, another small variety arose. They started calling themselves the dump gnomes, and the rat people, as they shared their habitats with rats. Some even named them kobolds. They lived around the rubbish heaps of human towns, recycling and repurposing a wide variety of things that humans and even other gnomes considered useless and of no value. Gradually, the different gnome peoples started forming their own stories and mythology.